Mark Davis, Eli Lilly, Don Swift. They were all part of this group called the Proprietary Association, and they controlled the cannabis market. And they blocked all legislation from around 1909 through 1937. The last time was the Uniform Narcotic Drug Control Act, and that was Anslinger not being able to get that into the Uniform Narcotic Act as he liked. And so he learned his lesson. He didn't want to challenge it.
Hey guys, it's Mandy with Global Hemp Association. I wanted to say thank you so much for joining. I'm excited about the opportunity to build a relationship and connect this supply chain. I mean, after all, that's why we started the association. Our association was built on the foundation of connecting supply chain, building relationships, and helping you grow your business. Anyone from farmers, manufacturers, and distributors, people that are passionate about the supply chain, and those creating products selling into biofuels, plastics, textiles, construction, and building materials.
I'm really excited about this interview today. John, thanks so much for joining me. I really appreciate it.
Yeah, no, I'm excited to finally be here.
Yeah. Well, and your name has been, you've been in the industry for quite a while and been thrown around, and you've been working on some big projects. And so I'm really excited to share what you're up to and maybe make some connections. So before I get to talking too much, John, I'm curious, like before the hemp industry, what's your background and how'd you get into this?
Oh, it's a long story, but I'll try to get it down in a tight little compact form here. But I've been in the hemp business or in and around it since I was a young adult coming out of college. I ended up getting a history degree, and what happened was I was idealistic back in my youth, and I thought I was going to solve why marijuana was made illegal. And I came across the book Jack Herrera's Emperor Wears No Clothes, became really interested in the fact that there were government documents in the book. That to me was the most interesting aspect of it, that he had photocopied like Bulletin 404 that showed hemp herds were being used for paper, and the Senate and House hearings and things of that nature. And that kind of got me thinking that there must be more records back in DC. And sure enough, there were, but they were classified. So I had to file a Freedom of Information Act, and I got access to the Federal Bureau of Narcotics Marijuana Tax Act file. And that was an interesting experience. I got to go into the DEA and mark off the documents that I wanted photocopied for my thesis work. Ended up writing thesis, demonization of marijuana. And I think it's still posted on Vote Hemp, but it was kind of a jump off point. I realized that I was only seeing part of the story at that point. At the time, I thought I could potentially go on and get a PhD in the subject matter, but it was kind of it was kind of frowned upon back in the late 80s, early 90s. We were still pretty deep in the drug war. And I went to a pretty conservative school at Pepperdine University. So it was pretty lucky I even got to do my thesis material as it was. So I got the message from academia that they didn't want me to go down that path or even continue with what I was doing. So I decided I was going to do it myself, and I ended up taking a job, you know, waiter and stuff like that back in New York, and making pilgrimages down to DC to go into the new archives. And down there, I really delved into the USDA records and other government agencies that were associated with it, with hemp and marijuana. And in general terms, what I was looking at is what was the relationship between marijuana prohibition and the hemp industry. And it turned out that there was something there. And so what happened was kind of typical to what we see today with lobbyists. There was a lobby group. It was called the Foreign Policy Association. Mm-hmm. They did not want it. And the reason behind all this was World War I debt. And this is, of course, my hypothesis, but mm-hmm. take it or leave it. It was World War I debt. So there were massive debts after World War I, and they were being repaid with global trade. Back then, the two fibers that were the top were cotton and jute. And jute was related to hemp. the people in America, the farmers and the entrepreneurs that wanted to develop hemp, wanted to replace jute. That was their primary target, and that didn't go over well because jute was a major commodity at the time, and the British controlled that market. They allowed American companies to come in like Bemis and Ludlow, and that was a way that World War I debt was repaid. And there's a clear precedent for this in the documents, as far as the congressional record, with Bemis being on record in that time period, around 1929, basically explaining the way this policy worked. And then there were loans or grants. No, there were loans, the PWA loan during the Depression that was going to go to the hemp industry to set up a new, they were going to bring hemp into the modern era, basically. And so they had a PWA loan, Public Works Administration loan, that was killed by the Secretary of Agriculture. And lo and behold, this lobbyist for the Foreign Policy Association, they were involved together with this. And then after the loan was killed, private interests picked it up and financed it. And there was a company developed called AmHempCo. They set up in Danville, Illinois. And they were the reason for why marijuana came into the lexicon. And so you have this lobbyist, she goes to people at Treasury over Commissioner Anslinger, the typical target for all this, and or scapegoat, I should say. They go to the Treasury people, then it goes, trickles back down to Anslinger. Of course, Anslinger did not want to touch marijuana because he had tried it in the past and been beat down. And the reason why he was beat down is because there was a pharmaceutical cannabis industry. So there was an actual lobby group for these people, for the pharmaceutical industry back then, that was selling medicinal cannabis, you know, like Park Davis, Eli Lilly, Doane, Squibb. They were all part of this group called the Proprietary Association, and they controlled the cannabis market, and they blocked all legislation from around 1909 through 1937. The last time was the Uniform Narcotic Drug Control Act, and that was Anslinger not being able to get that into the Uniform Narcotic Act as he liked. And so he learned his lesson. He didn't want to challenge these people. So then after that, what happened was the Foreign Policy Association came in and they started talking about marijuana. This is the first time you really see that name in the Bureau of Narcotics being pushed. And it's directly related. You can see on Anslinger's card from this lobbyist, Helen Moorhead from the Foreign Policy Association. He has written down the acreage of hemp, not marijuana stuff, but the acreage of hemp that was being grown in Illinois and Minnesota by AmHempCo and some smaller companies in Minnesota. So there's a clear correlation there. And then the next 2 years were spent trying to figure out a way to actually prohibit it. So they did this, behind the scenes. They had secret meetings. Foreign Policy Association drafted the Marijuana Tax Act in late 36. They brought in all the pharmaceutical companies, cut a deal with them, gave them opium importation permits not to come to the House Ways and Means Committee hearing. So that's why there was no one else there. And it was just that one doctor, Dr. Woodward. And long story short, blows through the Ways and Means Committee, no notification for the hemp companies. Hemp companies are going into production in 1937. They've developed all sorts of cool stuff. They're cottonizing fiber. They're going to use it in upholstery for automobiles. They're making the plastic that you see that Henry Ford's talking about. It's this clear, almost like a cellulose acetate. I'm not exactly sure what they were doing, but they had several different types of plastic. They were basically making a purified cellulose pulp and impregnating it. And making a really hard plastic. And that was the auto body plastic. So they had all this lined up, ready to go, huge stack of hemp in Danville, Illinois, right off the freeway there. I think it's 70, I think is what goes through there. But at any rate, they didn't tell the hemp companies. So they give them a month before the Senate hearings. Hemp companies are like, what is marijuana? Don't have any idea. But during that month, that's when the negotiations occurred to get the Tax Act exemption that still exists in the Controlled Substance Act, that the mature stocks are exempted. So that's where that all comes from.
Right.
Tax Act still passes with that exemption, but because of this stigmatization or demonization, as I referred to it in my thesis, you have all the investors pulling out. So the investors were the Ball brothers of Muncie, Indiana. So you know the Mason jars, that company, those guys were involved in it. And a bank called the Bank of New York was also a financier. And so they both pulled out at that time, and they had to go into a bankruptcy sort of deal where they went in and were going to form a co-op. And so this was being presented in December or October. I think the Tax Act went into effect in October, and the hearing was in December. And during the hearing, the president's like revealing the plan for reorganization under bankruptcy, that, you know, the farmer's going to be brought in, it's going to be a co-op, they're going to share profits basically. And someone comes running into the courthouse that the bales are on fire. Everything goes up in fire. Sheriff, you know, 40, whatever, how many ever years it was until I came into Danville and talked to the sheriff. And sheriff tells me it was the happiest day in this town because everyone was high, basically. The joke. Anyway, they didn't have any insurance, so they lost everything. That's when it ends. Yeah. It kind of comes back again during World War II. But that's how we ended up with marijuana prohibition, and it got squashed. And there's a lot more to the story. I'm going to just gloss over that because that I learned all this during the 90s, and I was still idealistic. I thought I was going to, write a book. I still have it, but I never went down the publishing track. I did go down the movie treatment track. I became involved kind of peripherally with the D'Angelos. They helped fund some of the research, the guys that started Harborside. Great guys. And then they, of course, in 96, they went off to California and started that. That all kind of fell apart. But then I got involved with, Joe Hickey and Woody Harrelson and those guys, and kind of got off on a movie treatment tangent and put that together. And then 2001 happened, and 9/11 and everything kind of came to a screeching halt. And I kind of was sitting there wondering what I was going to do. But during this whole period of time, hemp had been reintroduced in the West, Western Europe, Canada, places like that, Australia. I was watching the developments. I was studying, how the Europeans were developing these short line fiber systems like the Tamafa line and Lin line, the lines that basically got put in hemp flax, and those developments and how that was occurring. And I kept thinking, what I was seeing in all these records was really about entrepreneurship and R&D at the ag level and at the technical level and processing, and how they were going to bring hemp into the modern era. And there was also a lot of product development as well. And I kept thinking, there's got to be a way for me to take this and move it forward. And I talked to the D'Angelos a little bit. They had a hemp import distribution company back then called Evolution. And nothing really materialized there. But after 2001, I kept thinking, how am I gonna move this forward? And I had met Barbara Philippone of Viral Textiles back at Evolution with the D'Angelos. And Barbara asked me to come work with her. And we were gonna develop a decorticator. That was kind of the beginning genesis of that. It must have been 2005, sometime around then. I worked with her for a couple of years. It didn't work out. It was a great experience, though. And at about 2007,
she's been around in the industry for quite a while. Also, just focused.
Oh yeah, at least mid '90s. She was one of the first people into China and into Romania as well. Just a brilliant person with the fabrics. Really, really knowledgeable, but. I ended up, after I left working with Barbara, I ended up just trying to figure it out on my own. So I had this huge learning curve. I'd been kind of studying a little bit about it and trying to figure out how I was going to do it. But that was my real jump off point. And I ended up getting a little bit of financing, founding my first company, which will remain unnamed, and built my first decorticator, filed my first patent. The first decorticator was... a little decorticator, about 2 inches wide, framed out in plywood. And I ended up working with that for about 2 years while we built a larger version. And it was during that period of time I would process in my garage, and we were mainly working with seed flax straw because investors at that time didn't want to get involved with something that we couldn't grow in America. So seed flax straw had a history with the USDA. There had been work done in the early 2000s to try to see if they could make fiber from seed flax straw. So there had been work done with seed flax straw and canaf. And I just fell back on that research and started working with the USDA cotton ginning lab and developing relationships there and learning about cotton ginning. So that's when I started to learn, how are we going to put together a system? And with my first company, we actually had, when we had the decorticator completed, we also informed a MTA, a mutual transfer agreement with the USDA, and it brought in a bunch of equipment to Omaha, Nebraska, when the first farm bill passed. But unfortunately, I got exited from my company and never got to see that come to fruition. So that was in 2014, and I started my next company that year. I had to start all over again, built another decorticator, same basic design, because it was based on prior art that I learned about during my studies. Built that machine. We actually got a line set up in Nebraska, in Plattsmith, operated that for from about 2016 to 2018. We did a lot of great work. We had an opportunity to work with Marty and take over some of his, Marty at Old Dominion Hemp. We had an opportunity to work with him and take over some of his contract, but we couldn't actually come to a price point that would work for my group. So we ended up not doing that, putting all our focus on textile grade fiber, which was a great experience, learning experience. I developed a process, a wet process, was able to get hemp spun at a 20S yarn at a 20% blend rate. But I took away a lot of learning during that process and what are the real limiting factors of making a quality textile grade hemp fiber? And there's a lot. And so I don't do that anymore. we did make that first yarn, and we did make some fabrics. We worked with a company called Recreator, and they ended up with the yarns and everything and did some pretty cool things with 3D printing. But I don't know where that's gone now. But that was basically where I took my former company to. We did started working on some advanced material work too. To kind of back up, my spiel that I always give with hemp is you have a 1,000-pound bale. Out of that 1,000-pound bale, you have maybe 75-80% of that is wood. The remainder of that 25% to 20% is fiber. When you process it, you're going to have even more losses. So say 20 to 15% fiber. You can have higher amounts with some of these fiber varieties, but technically in America right now, we don't see that too much. It's mainly like dual purpose and not as high a density. So we don't get as high a yield of the fiber. So it's even less fiber, particularly with the hemp that I was working with back in 2016 timeframe. It was really low density. So it was maybe even 18% fiber that I was working with. But point being is you have a very small amount of hemp fiber versus hemp, the hemp wood or hemp herd. So you have to have markets for that wood, and you have to develop those markets. So I spent an inordinate amount of time trying to figure out ways to develop products out of that. So I focused on particularly on micronization. I must have tested on 10 or more different systems. I've sent herd to Israel to be tested on a specialized jet mill over there, gotten down to 10 micron. But in the process, I learned a lot about these different milling technologies. So it's been an eye-opening experience with all that as well. But we did some of the first composite blending. I worked very closely with Chad at C2 Renew to dial that in. We developed a really cool plastic that was comparable to a high grade nylon that was used for high end sunglasses. We actually never actually put that into production, but we got that done through Chad with a new type of cellulosic resin that had come out called Treba. So I'm pretty proud of that. I've done a lot of that work with the micronization in plastic. So I have a background with that as well. And know some of the pitfalls there as well as with the wet processing and all that with the cottonized fiber. But back to that analogy, say you have 200 pounds of fiber recovered during decortication. You go into a wet process and your best case scenario, you're going to get, 2-to-1 on that. So you get half of what you put in comes back as a spinnable fiber. And that's if you have like the best equipment after the wet process, because there's a whole nother, gradual step process to get that opened up and refined to actually go on to a cotton card and blend. Because in a spinning mill, you have cotton cards. Those cotton cards are set to the specifications of cotton fiber, which are like 15 micron, very, very small micron diameter, and very short fiber too. So if you have hemp, which has a wide range of diameters, if you're not on that mark, that fiber gets tossed out or torn up and goes out as trash. So you have even more losses there. So it's very difficult to get a high-end textile grade fiber to go through a short staple cotton spinning system with any kind of consistency and with the economics that you need to make that work for a decortication facility or processor. So anyway, I don't want to go too far off the tangent on that stuff.
I love it. This is the kind of stuff that like I don't know some of this, and so it's hard for me to dive into. So I love that you just broke down the process a little bit further on what's required to get a quality textile
extremely difficult. I mean, the Chinese do it, but they do it with a lot of labor. They have long ribbons, which it's a labor intensive process to do that. You need some alignment with your decortication process, or you need to manually hand strip that material, which is still done in the jute industry. And then you have to tie that, like when you go to the wet process, then they actually take these long ribbons, tie them off and put them into a cure. And it's not loose fiber all over the place. It's these ribbons. And then they take them out, they cut the ends off, and they keep aligning them through the process. And they have to keep that alignment in order to peel off or just refine it down to a very, they get these long fibers. Guy Carpenter's a specialist on this. And he's the world renowned expert for sure. But he always pulls out these golden hemp fibers, he calls them. And they're just beautiful. I mean, it's like hair, but to get that fiber, the amount of work that is required is a phenomenal amount of work. And then Patagonia, Alexandria, touched on this in her conversation with you. With the wet process, there are any number of ways to do it. Enzymes, there's tons of different processes there. But if you break it down and you look at what actually works, you have to use chemistry that raises the pH up to a level that is problematic environmentally. So if you're not at that pH, you will not remove the stuff that you need to get out. So the fiber is composed of three polymers: cellulose, which is the fiber; hemicellulose, which is a sugar again, but not as structured as the cellulose; and the lignin, which is really the stuff you need out. So you got to get those other two components out to a degree, but not break the fiber down to a point that it just starts totally falling apart and becoming a pulp. So it's difficult, and you need to have that chemistry at a certain way in order to do that. Now there are fancy solvents out now, like ionic liquids and DES, deep eutectic solvents, and systems like that that might offer ways to do this, but no one's really gone into that type of research. But these solvents potentially could be recycled and used for reused in the process, but they're currently, it's pretty expensive, so it's prohibitive. But since I touched on that, I do work in that field as well, because I believe that that hemp needs to go towards that more advanced material route, to where we're making like a regenerated cellulose. So that's a kind of a good bridge point to talk about what I do now. So when I left my former company, I ended up meeting up with Ryan Doherty, younger guy from who had been working with another company in the hemp space. And he kind of had more of a marketing and sales background. So it matched up well with my tech and innovation background. And we came together, I just joined his company, Hemp Ventures. And we started working down in Texas initially. We're going to kind of build on to a cotton gin with a gentleman down there. That didn't work out. In the process of that, I was looking at some used ginning equipment, and I came across a mill that's used in the automotive recycling space, primarily to recover copper. And I noticed the design, because when I walked by the mill, I saw it open, and I saw the design. I said, this mill can decorticate. Brought in some, I knew that from work with micronization that I had done, and we were seeing that the micronization process could also decorticate. But the mills just weren't designed right. So like, I had tested on like the pulse wave mill, the guys from Revive use, I had tested on that before it had come out of all the patent litigation, back in 2014. But at the time, I think Ryan, Laughlin had tested on it too, right before me. But when I tested on that machine, I realized that if it was designed differently, it could do decortication, but the cost to redesign it was just ridiculous, and it was in kind of a patent dispute, and that's been resolved, and it's now with those guys at Revive now. But that mill, and then I worked with another mill out in Michigan, the Enagon mill, and we've realized for a long time that we could decorticate with these, and we've kind of proven out that the Enagon mill could decorticate, or can decorticate. They have a version of that that we could potentially use. But long story short, this mill that I saw was a monstrosity. So I knew it could go high capacity and could decorticate. We brought in some of the old, bales from Kentucky, and, did some trials on that, got really good results, realized we had to do a couple different things to make the system work properly. But, that was the basis for a jump off. And, we ended up connecting with another company out of Missouri and, setting up a line around that type of mill for them. And that's now in operation, and it's one of the top lines in America. Very proud of that. Those guys are doing some great things out there now too. And, that was our, like, the big milestone for us was 2022 when that got up and running. And, it proved itself out. So that's great. Love it. But in the process of that, we kind of realized it was going to be difficult to work with the mill manufacturer. So we came up with some alternatives during that process. We've since found other versions of that mill that go back in the prior art and precede it. And so we know that now, as well as we've innovated on our own. And so the innovation on our own, we've actually created a cooperative agreement with the USDA and have a small version of that mill that is being kind of innovated on and put into the microgen down in Mississippi. And we've done some trial work with them already and realized how we could set that up and have greater efficiency. So that work is proceeding still down there. And we didn't want to sit around. And so we ended up, the guys this back here is Prairie Pro. They're up in Olivia, Minnesota. I came up and had a meeting with them. I've been working with them since 2019, I think. I've helped them out, tried to help them out. And they've been progressively working towards getting a system up and operational here. So I came up and presented an option for them to get up and running. And we're putting that in right now, all the equipment's here. And I'm actually working to get that set up in the middle of a blizzard, but I'm excited about that. that's coming online here, hopefully here real soon, and will be a jump off point for them to, you know, expand and put in a much larger facility go from there. And so with Ryan on the team, then we'll help on the back end with marketing. So Hemp Ventures kind of can provide system solutions custom tailored to the end user. And then we can also help with the product development and sales on the back end. And then we're also working with Whitefield Global Holdings. And we are now in the midst of putting in a system with them up in Rexburg, Idaho. I never knew hemp would be growing up there, but it's actually, we're discovering that agronomically it's beneficial for the potato rotation. So that's great. And so we're going to focus on fiber hemp there. And we have a larger line going in there. All the equipment is, almost all the equipment's on site now. So we're in the installation phase up there as well. So very excited about that. Similar situation. We plan on helping with the marketing and development of products there as well. And jump off from that. The other thing that I do is on the advanced materials side. So I started that work with my former company. We were working down in Alabama with kind of the godfather of ionic liquid technologies down in Alabama. We did some work to develop some filaments. Just couldn't get enough traction. I had actually stepped down as CEO, and the CEO was kind of working on that. And we collaborated and did a little bit of work, but then when I exited out of that company, they dropped that and focused on textile fiber, I think. So I don't really know exactly what's going on there, but that work showed a lot of promise. I hated leaving that, but I did. But in the process, I figured out another way to approach the problem, and ended up at NC State several after that, took out a license on a technology. And then that technology, to get the funding to move that forward, I got involved with a group out of Minneapolis, and they now are the license holders on that technology. And we're about 6 months into that project, and we're just getting 3D printer filaments blends with PLA, where we have PLA blended with dissolved hemp. And we're not just we're also using like soy hulls and other materials as well. But
what's it mean to say when you say dissolved hemp?
So we use, okay, so the technology is meltable solvents. The solvents are safe. They're actually food grade. So they're totally non-toxic. The solvents, when they melt, they dissolve the hemp. So they break so whether it's hemp herd, hemp shells, whole shells, or hemp fiber, what happens is the polymers that are all together and bonded together become unlocked, and then they become dissolved into solution. And from that point, you can extract the cellulose, the hemicellulose, the lignin. You can go wherever you want with that stuff, or you can just use it directly. Like the fiber, we could just use directly because it has a low lignin content. But that's basically what that is. It's a new way to rapidly pulp in a continuous process, and then get your basic polymers out of that, whether it's cellulose, whatever, and make whatever you want from that point. We're targeting 3D printer filament, injection molding type pellets, that type of stuff, as well as isolating lignin and also regenerated cellulose. Hopefully the regenerated cellulose process will work out with direct melt spinning, which would be a major advance because the technologies that exist today. So rayon, of course, is highly toxic because they use a solvent called carbon disulfide. So rayon viscose processes are only done in like China and a third, basically countries that don't have strict environmental regulations. So your viscose is toxic, but Lensing, another company, has developed a process called, it's a lyocell process, which uses another type of ionic liquid, but you have to have a high quality dissolving pulp or purified cellulose. And so the Lensing uses, they go down to the Brazil or Brazil forest and the Amazon, clear cut, set up monoculture eucalyptus farms, and then pulp that and then bring it into, say, like Mobile, Alabama. And at that point, it's a good closed loop process, but you're still using an energy intensive pulping process to get the not a very desirable means of forestry either when you're cutting down the Amazon. So that's kind of the secret of lyocell or tensile. But those kind of fabrics are fibers, I should say, those regenerated cellulosics are like the highest quality fibers out there. I don't know if you've ever had like a tensile shirt or they blend it with merino wool now or alpaca, but it makes the softest fiber. So it's actually the fastest growing segment of the textile market. So we're looking at that as well. And that's with a company, I work with a group of really great business guys out of Minneapolis, Minnesota, called the larger holding company is called Realm 5, but the group this work is organized under is called R5 Labs. So
awesome.
I think I covered everything actually in my little
in your little studio. That was pretty good.
I mean, over the years, I've looked at other types of processes as well, particularly product innovation. I've done work with lost circulation materials and potential cementing additives. I even have a project that I work on right now that we're supplying fiber for, that's a new way to do 3D printing with the fiber for building. So cement, the construction with the fiber instead of the hempcrete path. I haven't done a whole lot with hempcrete, but I had some lengthy conversations with Kevin from Hemp Adobe when he was around, and really believed that his process had a lot of promise and he had some great vision. It's too bad he's not around anymore, but there are the building materials market, I think, has huge potential.
Yeah, I absolutely agree with you. Okay, so you said a couple of things that I'm curious about. Do you know why we're finding success, or why potato rotation hemp is successful in a potato rotation? What's happening?
Yeah, so I had the benefit of sitting in on a growers meeting last week, and okay. we that was a topic of discussion because we were talking about obviously they grow potatoes there, and the nematodes that attack potatoes, apparently when hemp is planted, it breaks that cycle, the disease cycle. Another thing they thought was really advantageous was wheat apparently takes up a lot of excess nutrition, whereas hemp, it's in and out and it doesn't have that same impact on the nutrition. So there's a benefit there. And then because hemp comes out early for fiber, there's a benefit for water as well. So those were the three takeaways I had during the meeting that seemed really, really interesting from an agronomic perspective.
And then there was another question. I wanted to share your contact info. If people are want to get in touch, if they want to work with you, if they want to contact, how do people get in touch with you?
Mainly, through the website, Ryan or I will respond there. Ryan primarily would respond on the website, but that email that just flashed up, it's just J-O-H-N, John, pretty common name, with hempventures.org is my email. You can get in touch with me there. That'd be the easiest way.
Awesome. Awesome. Okay. So then there was another question that came up. Fred, it's good to see you also. Milan, I saw you were on, and Todd, of course, thanks for joining. Ray, thank you again for popping on. But Fred had a question. Did you overcome the color or odor characteristics with wind plastic compounding? I've heard from a lot of auto industry that, you know, both the mold and color are the number one killers in moving product into composites or into their materials. And then also when getting down to 10 micron, where you're seeing a visible fiber striations at the end product.
I never actually saw the end product at 10 micron. It was just the, they give you a range of what, you know, when they do the particle size analysis, it came down, the peak was at 10 micron. So it was, that was the best I ever did, but this was with a jet mill. So the amount of air that would have been required for that, it would have been prohibitive. Most of the milling equipment out there will, you won't have a uniformity down below a certain point. And so with the particle size, so you get a range, and then you have, if you need to be at a very low micron, you're going to have to recycle. So it keeps going back through again and again and again, which is what prohibits getting to very fine micron sizes in one pass, which then impacts the economics of what you're talking about. Because if, you know, these systems and the energy requirements, you start stacking that up to get a uniform micron, you know, low micron, it's going to be very difficult to do and expensive. That's kind of why I've gone, I went off on this other path where instead of worrying about micron, let's just dissolve this and reform it. And that's where we can get the uniformity at, is that way. As far as the color and the odor, that's, you know, that's kind of problematic with some of the other components in there that are volatile. And so that's a temp issue. Like, you know, say you're using like a crystallized PLA, CPLA, you're going to have a much higher melt temperature for that. That's going to in turn probably impact some of the lower molecular weight components of the herd per se, like the hemicellulose and particularly the lignin. Especially if there's water, you're going to have like reactions that occur that it's going to be difficult to control. Yeah, 150 micron is that's a kind of a standard for double hammer milling. That's kind of where you can get to, and then getting under that is difficult. There are types of mills that can help with that, but the problem is like you're going to always have a portion that you have to put back through to keep getting there. So it's half again, back through cycling. So then your material that you're putting through at the first point, it keeps getting lower and lower because you have to bring more through. So, the herd and those materials, I would like to have thought that they would be more like a reinforcer and less of a filler, but I think they're more or less just a filler. And so you're competing against very low cost fillers on the larger market. So is it just a marketing gimmick that we have with hemp or not? I don't know. I mean, that's a tough one. There's different ways to compatibilize other issues like that. So, but that's not my expertise per se, that chemistry. I would really, in that field, I would defer to like Chad at C2 Renew. He's definitely been working with these materials the longest amount of time that I know of. But there are other companies out there that are starting to get into it. But again, it's, it's an issue of what is the hemp bringing that other things don't bring, and what benefits are you getting out of that?
Impact strength is the hardest, you said.
To maintain. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And yeah, then yeah, these are all good points. Talc powder is, it's so cheap. Exactly. You are correct, sir.
Yeah. Well, and I think that's something that we really need to be aware of, right? When we look at these facilities that are coming online and what's the end product they're processing for, and is it a market that's going to drive the industry, or once we get these other facilities online, what does that look like? And I'm curious, we kind of talked about the processing facilities and the number of locations you're involved in. What does scale look like? And what does, the next few years look like for processing and for being able to, meet specs or fulfill contracts that actually meet specs that are needed to.
We need uniformity of the materials, and that starts at the field. So that's one thing. Some of that can be overcome with these new technologies, but we don't have those commercialized yet. So that's not available to us. So we really, we're dealing with commodity materials that we need uniformity for. So when I design these systems, I'm looking at, I need a very clean herd, and I need a cottonized fiber, mechanically cottonized fiber. So we are able to get, you have losses during that. So you have to know what to do with the material that you can, that comes off that, particularly with the fiber. And with the herd too, you're going to have a range of particle sizes. You're never going to have exactly the right size. I mean, my decorticator at my previous companies that I, the patented one and the one I developed second after that, we were able to get a very uniform herd size, but the trade-off was, is that you had to have kind of a uniform, a parallel to the path of alignment stocks. You had to feed them in with alignment, which is difficult. You have some of that with other systems as well. But if you go around that and you use other systems like we're using now, the sacrifice for that herd uniformity is kind of a wide range of particle sizes. So, how do you dial that in? How do you get product from that that's uniform? So, it's basically like we set a spec at about 6 millimeters, which is right under 1/4 inch. So the spread is around that, right under 1/4 inch on herd. So you have a lot of material that's under that, and you have a lot of material over that, that's really what I would refer to the building grade stuff. And then over like 1/2 inch is what I would refer to overs that would go back into the system. And then on the fiber side, you end up with, maybe out of your total, maybe 60 to 70% of a really good, clean, cottonized fiber. I mean, zero herd, that under 1%. Dirtiness, and very uniform. When you run it on the right equipment, you're going to get a very uniform fiber in that range of 3/4 inch to about 1.5 inch. And it's difficult to like maintain that. You can kind of, depending on the system and how you're doing it, you can get a little bit longer fiber, but you're really getting a very soft, very individualized bast fiber at that point. And that's what you're going, what we go for. Which is different from a lot of other systems. So that's how we kind of approach it. And we're seeing good feedback on from non-woven companies on this type of material. I think we could probably spin it into some of the coarser yarns. It wouldn't be the primary fiber. It would probably carry kind of similar to work that was done with a cone denim. I think those are some of the ways we could use that material. The trash, of course, I would go with the pulping route, dissolving it, the systems that we're talking about for the advanced materials. And the herd, the smaller stuff down to the fines, that's really excellent for industrial type absorbance. That could be highly competitive in that market. And there's ways to functionalize that and give it different properties, but there's kind of precedent for that with canaf. So there's a good pathway for industrial type absorbance for oil spill, stuff like that. And then the bigger material, of course, into the hempcrete. And you could mix the two in those two ranges, like down to 1/8 inch up to 1/2 inch could be like a general animal bedding. But the key there is dust and short fiber out. Short fiber can go into like the absorbance, but like bedding and building materials, that has to be out. So the systems have to be capable of delivering that right out of the gate. So that all goes into the design of a system, but it's to get to a more or less a commodified material that you can count on and say, okay, this is going to meet this spec every single time. As long as the hemp isn't full of pigweed or something, or we have issues like that, which I've had.
I was going to say, and that's something that we're seeing more and more, both on, in the bale of hemp that comes in, depending on where it's planted and how it's planted, and then also the seed, like sorting seed size. I'm learning that there are some very similar, both in color and size, seeds that become problems when we're sorting, and so. Yeah, there's these new nuances that are coming up, but
there's
not
a lot.
Yeah. Okay.
Funny story about pigweed. I mean, I was running that at my old company, and you know, my employee comes back to me and says, "There's no fiber coming out of the machine." I mean, I've been moving stuff through this thing, and why is there no fiber coming out? Well, it turns out the pigweed looks a lot like hemp when it's been redded and dried. So we were just bales of pigweed blasting through it. But yeah, no, we've had a lot of that. But on that point with the seed too, you know, I mentioned we're doing work with the seed holes, with the soy holes. The remarkable thing, they have these unique properties, these really tight nanocrystalline structures. We think the same thing is in hemp seed holes as well. So we're doing some of the dissolution work with hemp seed holes as well, hopeful that we're going to see the same properties, and we can be able to create a market for those hemp seed holes that would give it value, that would help take the the weight off the other side of the hemp seed processing, which is, you know, de-hulling. You're losing so much weight when you de-hull, but you know, it's a great product, but the economics can be difficult.
Yeah. Okay. So talk to me scale. We only have a few minutes left, but what does scale, you know, every time, for example, I had three interviews today, this week, all three were about different decortication facilities that we're opening next few months. Right. Mm-hmm. And so what does that look like as far as scale for the industry, and how do we start to meet demand of some of these larger organizations or potential contracts that are coming down the pipeline?
Well, let me start with scale. Scale is relative to the energy input into the equipment. So, you know, 200 to 300 horsepower might get you to 4 tons an hour. You know, we think that's a reasonable amount for that amount of horsepower, like 100, 125, 2 tons an hour, you know, good steady pace there. And then that the breakdown comes out along the lines like I was just discussing, as far as like how that all fractionates out. But the second part of your question, the market is we have not had a hemp industry. So we have not had hemp going into American manufacturing in any form, whether it's hemp herd or hemp fiber. So there's not a very good understanding of what it's going to take to scale this. So you're really working backwards. So you heard a lot of that in Alexandra's talking about the work that they've been doing in Patagonia. I mean, there's a huge, huge learning curve. And it's, you know, if you're spinning fiber, those guys spinning the fiber, they don't have a whole lot of knowledge of how to spin hemp. So it's very difficult. We were very fortunate to work with a company that was forward thinking and let us come into the mini lab and spin and work directly with them. It was great, but you don't have that reception everywhere. And so it's very difficult to break in on that front, but we're seeing that there's a lot of receptivity now around the sustainability issues and getting biofiber into materials. And with, talks with different nonwoven companies, they use natural fibers already, but they kind of, particularly in nonwovens, they use them more as a filler. So how do we kind of shift that into the more higher end applications and get more acceptance? And that's going to come with that uniformity at the processing level. So, you know, and then they're going to, the volume that they need could be huge. So we have to be able to scale that. So with uniformity. So these systems that we're designing where you can just dump a bale in and then blast it through, I think they're the way of the future. I mean, you have them in Europe too, but I think based on, you know, what our systems cost and what we can do with our technologies, we exceed anything coming out of Europe right now. I'll put my money on that. American cotton cleaning equipment is superior to any kind of fiber cleaning equipment in the world. And we have solutions for the herd cleaning and refinement. Those are those are standard, easy technologies to apply. So yeah, Guy Carpenter's right, consistency and scale. So you have to be able to dial that in all the way through from your crop, how you handle it. You know, we're recommending just basic dry down, you know, minimize the amount of redding so we don't have to worry about the variability that redding's gonna, you know, cause. You know, harvesting it at a point that, you know you have that uniformity, that you're not, obviously we can use dual purpose stocks from, but you're gonna see some variation in that versus a dedicated fiber crop. So we have to be able to dial in all these components all the way through to scale it and get that consistency. So I think those things are coming around. I mean, one of the things I'd like to mention too is in working with Whitefield, the thing that's attracted us to working with the guys at Whitefield, John Reed and his team, is they have one of the best farm programs I've ever seen. They actually offer crop insurance. So they have a very, and they come out of agriculture, so they know how to manage that aspect of it, where me, in my background, that wasn't something I was totally familiar with. You know, I grew out of contracts, a little bit of hemp, but there is a whole other level of that at that level that you have to be familiar with to scale at large volume, understanding how to, you know, make it economically work. And that's something that, you know, you have to collaborate and work together to get to that point.
Absolutely. Well, I'm going to give a shout out to Jamie on their team is fabulous. So yeah, shout out.
I'm excited to be working with her.
Yes, I love those guys. They're great. And so, John, I've appreciated this. We've had lots of comments and lots of feedback. If you end up catching this later on when it's recorded, either played on our podcast channel or recorded and seen on any of our websites or YouTube channel, don't hesitate to leave a comment or reach out. I'll share John's contact information again. I did have another question. Oh, key word that you had said earlier that I just want to highlight is that consistency and uniformity, like Guy said. And, you know, moving forward, I'm really curious, you know, about the conversations instead of being so much about what can be made, but how do we collectively meet that spec? What tweaks are being made without giving away IP, right? How do we really change that? And it's exciting to see you're doing that or changing the conversation. And it's exciting to see you're doing it at multiple locations. You've got facilities up and running. And so congrats and thanks for all of your hard work. And you'd mentioned Patagonia a couple of times. I want to give a huge thank you. I'm seeing all kinds of pictures posting and popping up. Patagonia gave a big thank you and sent out hundreds of jackets and coveralls and pants and stuff to our members. And so just out of an effort to say thank you guys for all of your hard work, that hemp really is a viable material or viable fiber, that you know, Patagonia is one company that really leaned in and is making waves. And so I just want to say thank you to them and thank you to everybody that participated. Enjoy your new Patagonia coat or gear that you ordered, and hopefully we'll get to do that again here soon. But other than that, John, anybody else you want to give a shout out to or anything you want to say before we sign off?
No, I'll probably think of something, but no. I've had a great time. It's been a pleasure coming on finally and talking with you and telling everyone what we're doing.
Well, let's do this again here soon. I'd love to catch up maybe at the end of the season and after, you know, more facilities are up and running. I've got a number of people on my list that I'm going to be targeting, especially this year since we've seen so much growth. And so don't hesitate, John, if anything comes up, I'd love to have you back or anybody on your team that you're working with to highlight.
Yeah, and we're actually talking about creating a bigger presence online. So I'm sure that will come up.
I love it. Love it. Love it. Great. Well, congrats on all you guys' hard work. Thank you again. Don't hesitate to reach out, you guys, if you need anything. We appreciate your support. Next week, we don't have any interviews, which is kind of nice. I was going to be out of town, and so I don't have anything scheduled. But keep an eye on our website, because the following week, we do have a couple of meetings and live interviews. But on globalhempassociation.org and friendsofhemp.org are all of our interviews listed. So other than that, thank you very much. John, I sure appreciate you.
All right. Thanks, everyone. Bye, man.
See you later.